5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome to the podcast, where the old school meets the new school. I am Tito Devon.
And I'm Tito Darius.
And we are
the Double D's.
It's Friday, Darius.
It's back. We're live once again. It's good to be here.
So in Europe, you have when you take a number two or number one on a public toilet or any toilets, you gotta pay.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's
That's Europe.
Yeah.
It's Europe. It's not a bad system if they're gonna clean it.
Yeah.
I don't mind that. Yeah. I'm happy with that.
So see this was happening. So I didn't have any cash.
So what happened?
So right in the toilet, the lady
paid with your body.
The lady stopped me, right? They're all lying and goes, "No, you can't go in." And it's like in Deutsch. I said, "I have to go. Do you take PayPal?"
What?
I left my key card in there.
Yeah, I said,
"You have to take it.
Yeah, you have to take it.
Dude, you have to go. So that was in Berlin. One, back in Thailand, we went on a trip, right? I had to hold it for 3 hours. Dude, I was sweating so bad because I was turning pale that I had to go.
You know, I felt like that. I've been in those situations.
So
effed up.
In the same time also, during the trip, I was still eating. I was like, they keep
Wait. You had to go, but you were eating.
Yeah, I was eating. I was still eating. Like, I was eating some, I don't know, fish crackers or whatever, peanuts.
Maybe it's just to take your mind off the actual...
Oh, man. But I could swear to God, when you have to go, you have to
go. Yeah, 100%. 100%.
So, it happens in majority in the train stations.
D, you remember a lot about your holidays that are in the toilet.
Yeah, I do.
I mean, I'm just observing
In Paris, that happened too. But in Paris, so when you're in France, right, you can use the public toilets. But the problem is there's a timer when you're in Paris. So you could get, I think every 30 minutes, 40 minutes.
The doors open.
The doors open, but they wash it.
Yeah, yeah.
So someone said, look at this, Darius. So if you are going to use the public toilet, be very careful because you don't want to be drenched. It's like a car wash.
Oh, it's self-cleaning.
It's self-cleaning, right?
I like that too. I like that as well.
Wow.
So, but if you're there, you're gone.
All right. Should we introduce Moby?
Okay, guys. We have a special guest right here. My apology. My heart's just beating right now coming from a trade up.
He's still sweating, I can see.
You can see he's sweating.
Unaware jiu-jitsu.
It's not from the desire to go to the toilet.
It's having a hot person next to me.
Oh, thanks, man.
Yeah, that's one thing. both of the guys are wearing black. Yeah.
Very, very cool.
So we are.
Guys, we have a CEO, a very,
very
successful entrepreneur. Moby, how would I pronounce your last name? Sadiq?
Yeah.
Right, there you go.
Well done. Oh, Yeah.
Raise the roof.
Mr. Moby Sadiq, welcome on board. As I said, he is the CEO, the founder of Red Panda.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yeah. Yes. Red Panda. Also,
digital marketer, a very, how would you say this, vocal on his social, and a very career minded and a very smart, a good looking person. May I ask? Single, married, or open-minded?
Oh, man, you know. This.
Oh, I really
you
don't know. This is public this, right now.
Yeah, you know, I got two kids. Married, definitely married.
Sorry, ladies and gents.
Yeah, definitely.
So, you have two lovely, one son and one daughter. Am I correct?
That's right, yeah. Both also go jiu-jitsu.
Yep.
Where we go, Gracie Parramatta. So, yeah.
So, yeah. As we all know, I met Moby through Gracie and Ernest. It's a great community once again. So that's why it's a lot of different people from different outcomes.
Yeah.
So once again, welcome.
Thank you.
Oh yeah, guys, yeah. Moby is half Filo.
No, I'm not. My wife is half Filo, but I do feel like an honorary Filo. That's for sure.
He does karaoke.
No, I love karaoke.
He loves
that
karaoke.
That probably makes me more Filo. I love karaoke. I love the magic mic being smashed out. I love how Filipinos just love to party. My kids are quarter Filipino. My wife's half Filipino.
Yeah.
So
she is half Filipino, right?
Yeah, she's half Filipino. Yeah.
So what's the other half?
Pakistani.
Yeah. Oh, okay, Pakistani. There you go. So father side.
It's always the woman is always Filipino, which I don't understand, because all the Filipino men I know, there's nothing wrong with you.
Oh,
guys.
There's plenty. There's plenty.
I don't know, guys.
always. Why do you even ask? It's always the father is always, you know, white or something else. You know what I mean?
Isn't that Joe Coy?
All
his jokes is like...
The father's American.
Yeah.
And the mother's...
He said, that's my mom's hustle.
Getting out from the Philippines.
Using
the passport. So, he's half Filipino and half Pakistani. That's a good mix, man.
She, by the way, just so.
She.
Let's not get it twisted. Okay. It's fine.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not an issue. Yeah, that's right. You know, like, let's not get it twisted, you know.
So, I guess being a karaoke king, and also, have you tasted a lot of Filipino foods?
Yeah, absolutely. What's that? Abodo chicken?
Adobo?
Adobo
chicken. The pancit.
Leche flan.
Now, I got to ask this. Have you ever tasted the balut or balot?
That sounds dirty. Like, I don't know. I feel like you're trying to ask me.
It's a duck egg.
Have you tasted? Can you swear on this show?
Yeah, go for it.
You know, have you tasted dick or something?
You can do that too. This one. I gotta ask.
Oh, I have heard about that. The half cooked chicken in a. That's disgusting, man.
Yeah, it's disgusting, eh?
Yeah,
that is disgusting.
I'll try dog instead. Don't worry about it.
You can't believe you gotta eat this,
that's
man.
That's disgusting. Can we change the screen?
No. Yeah. Oh, wait. Because, you know, guys, when Moby just said, can you swear? He said, have you ever tasted dick? Put Google. Soup number five. Soup number five.
What is soup number five?
You never. Oh, man, it's the best.
I feel like it's code for something.
No. You gotta watch this. You gotta read this.
Soup number five?
From bull's testes.
No. Go. Up.
Yeah.
Soup number five is made from bull's testes or penis.
Oh, what the hell?
Yeah, I don't know about that, man. I'd have to check if that's halal first. And then you know what I mean?
I don't get it. Why is it? The dish is called soup number five?
Yeah, soup number five. It's well in the South Philippines majority in the Mindanao. This is the first. It's an aphrodisiac. So it's from the beef or the bull.
Is this like some sort of, like, if you eat the bull, you get the bull?
No.
See, that's why no one's marrying Filipino men, because you guys, I don't mean that. I'm joking. I'm playing, guys.
Moby, talk about Red Panda.
Yeah, so it's very gracious. It's obviously Darius's job to make me look better than I am. But so it's a digital marketing agency.
Yeah.
We're based in Sydney. I've been around for about 4 years.
Wow.
Maybe 5 years.
Being a digital marketer or out there right now, so you opened this by your own co-founded?
No, interesting. We started with three founders at the time. And one founder, he got cold feet, whatever. And
okay,
that's so, okay.
That's
you know,
fine,
like some people
fine.
Can't take, you know, it's a big commitment investment. And after year one, I had another founder, and it was one of the hardest decisions I ever had to make, but I had to part ways with him. I learned a lot about running businesses and
partnership,
which was really, really sad, because we worked together, you know, we were colleagues, we were friends. It just didn't make sense. Like, there's certain people who
didn't click.
Yeah. Like, there's certain people who they, like, for example, family, like one of my best friends, like my best friend, Peter, he's a lovely guy. He's an awesome guy. I love him like a brother. He was the best man at my wedding, onto his daughter's christening and everything. But I would never work with him.
It's totally different.
I'd say that.
There, yeah,
like,
there.
I've said that to his face, you know, man, we're going to clash. Like, it's like, you know, you love no one more than your family, but you probably wouldn't go in business
with them. Like neurons, negative and positive. It works sometimes.
Nice. It definitely works sometimes. Yeah. But there's other people who you'd be business with, but you wouldn't necessarily, not
hang
that you wouldn't
them.
Be friends, but you wouldn't hang and chill with them.
Yeah, no, that's right.
So
well, I want to congratulate you.
One of the hardest things I ever had to do was... ask him to leave the business.
Wow.
And we started it together.
Are you still on talking terms?
No, which was really sad though, the thing is, I said to him, look, I'd love to work with you. You're an amazing designer. The problem was, you know, we're a digital marketing agency, so we do design, we do a bit of development.
SEO,
Facebook, social media. We do a lot of marketing automation.
Yeah.
Anyway, so what I was finding, and it's not like we didn't have the numbers, we had the numbers, I was finding that 75% of the revenue and therefore the work was coming from me. and only 25% of the revenue and 15% of the work, because we tracked everything. So at one point, I even sort of said, I gave him like chances. I said, dude, who better to train you on digital marketing than me? I'll train you on that so you can take some more of the workload.
Yeah.
And then even too, some people don't understand is when you go into a partnership, like if the three of us started business today, you know, we split three ways, 33%, but it doesn't mean we need to get the same wage.
That's correct.
Because that's different. You know, you split profit, and that's what people don't understand, that you can have different roles. You still have the same equity. So if you're the CEO, Darius, you might get, I don't know, $100,000. You know, I'll get $80,000. We both get $80,000 each, but we have a third of the business. So when you split the profit. So even I sort of said, look, I'm obviously doing more of the roles and the responsibilities. Let's change the wage structure or whatever. So anyway, so yeah, now it's
really hard, but I'm proud of you, my friend. I'm proud of these guys.
I guess some people.
I'm sitting in a live CEO. Have you ever did a speech on TED?
No.
But yeah, I've seen something. I speak
internationally. I've spoken in.
There you go.
Singapore, Hong Kong. I was supposed to be in Boston, but because of COVID, we didn't. So I did it remotely. But But yeah,
this guy's presenting really, right? I'm overwhelmed.
I'm more impressed. I'm more impressed that you recognized your value very early on. I'm more impressed by that. Like
it's a feeling. It's a gut feeling.
So prior to Red Panda, have you ever worked in a corporate?
Yeah, I did. I hated it. The way you see me now with a snapback and a t-shirt. Yep,
you're like me.
I like to go to work that way. When I have meetings, of course, I got to do what I got to do. But I worked client side. I worked corporate marketing. Worked, you know, at a head office that had 200 people, just that head office.
Yep.
So
how long? How long?
A few agencies as well.
How long with the last one in total? With before opening your firm or opening your business.
That is such a good question. And the reason why it's such a good question, people think that they can just do something.
No,
you have to do, you know, the 10,000 hour rule, you know, the 10,000 hours.
You have to do research.
If you haven't heard of that rule, it's, you know, it takes 10,000 hours to master something.
Yeah.
So if you did that every day, there's about 48 working weeks in a year. That means you'd have to do something for, I can't remember, I calculated 6 years or 8 years, right? You got to do 8 years full-time something to become a master in something.
Okay.
So these days, too many people, it's so funny, like I see so many people trying to get into what I'm doing. And get into what I'm doing, it's nothing wrong, but they haven't worked corporate side. That I worked 10, 15 years.
Before I opened my own business. So this is all you youngsters out there, or who wants to invest 10,000 hours at least.
It's a golden rule. And honestly, you feel it.
Not easy.
I feel it now. Like, and you talk about the speaking, but this is something I've been working on for a very, very long time. Yeah. I didn't make many good decisions in high school, but one of the best things I did was I put myself in from the seventh grade in debating and speaking a steadfast.
Yeah, communication's massive.
So
in everything.
You done Toastmasters?
No, but I feel like I don't need it now because I do recommend it.
Yeah, thank you. Because I am doing it.
I do recommend it. Like if you need a fast track, if you need a process, a pragmatic framework for speaking. But because I've done it the long way, I'm not going to get anything out of it now, me personally, you know. Mm-hmm. But so I did that for many, many years. And then I would volunteer to speak.
I like that.
And I always sort of say this. I've had my podcast since 2016. The skills you generate.
Yeah.
Like it helps you on stage. The skills you generate on stage help you in a one-on-one, help you in a boardroom.
Yeah.
And I think you touched on it a second ago, that communication skill.
It has to be clear and precise.
Is transferable.
That's good.
A few weeks ago, I emceed at a wedding. Not because I like to.
I know which wedding was that. Remember? It's a small world, you know? Yeah, it's just said, like one of my...
You knew the guy that was there.
Yeah,
you know,
I said like I wanted to attend that wedding then, but I couldn't. It's just a small world.
Wow.
Yeah.
And look, I hate emceeing weddings because I don't get nervous. I'm really, really excited. If there's like 4 or 5 people, if I'm invited to speak somewhere, 4 or 5 people, I'm kind of like, oh, okay. Like if there's, I was really upset in Boston because at Boston, it would have been my biggest, I still did it. I did it virtually. All the introverts were like, yay, we could do it at our desk as a webinar.
Yeah. The extroverts.
All the extroverts like, you know, like people like me and you.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I would have had 500 people.
You
want to
feel their energy.
Yeah, I
you're like
thrive
me, yeah.
off that.
I try.
But that doesn't happen overnight.
Nah.
That doesn't happen overnight. So I don't want people to think, oh, like, oh, that I don't feel like that. No one is a born, I don't give a shit what people say. No one's a born public speaker. It's just not possible.
It's the hardest job.
Yeah.
It's to practice. It's like any other sports or any other, how would you say this?
Craft.
A craft. Or career that you want to do. You want to hound it.
And why I say the wedding thing, the reason why firstly, you know, I did it because someone asked me, because like, oh, this guy knows how to talk. Can you MC a wedding of mine, or like a friend?
Wait. Someone said, this guy knows how to talk?
Well, because they see me do videos, they see me speak, they see me at events. And this guy, I actually know him, he's a friend, but also he's a business associate as well. We work together in that capacity. And he asked me, I'm like, yeah, cool, I'll do it. And the reason why, so it's not a good gig, not because like I get nervous. I don't get nervous. It's a shit gig because when you're emceeing a wedding, I remember I emceed another wedding, my wife's friend, it was in Hunter Valley, and someone had parked. Everyone comes to you with their problems.
Right.
Oh, we're like, that's late, or that's late. Some guy had parked his car on the field.
Oh, you got to say
and
a then, shout it
and
out.
And someone came to me, it's like, oh, some guy parked his car in my barn. And like the bride and groom about to walk in, I'm thinking in my head, I don't give a shit, man. Okay, no worries, all good, mate. I don't, you know what I mean? So why I like it, it's challenging.
Oh,
you know what I mean? So I have to communicate to a bunch of people. I have to carry, and what better honor to, you know, that responsibility of, you know, seeing someone's night, that happiness and being the facilitator. What better gift?
And they'll know you for life, man.
So the point I'm trying to make, it's a muscle. Communication is a muscle.
I like that.
So any opportunity you get, if someone asks you to do a speech, if someone says, I need you to do this presentation, you always take it. You always take it.
Wow.
So remember, on my eulogy, don't forget to call this guy, all right?
What just happened there?
Look,
what
happened? The best eulogy has ever. If we can do MC, you'll do.
I appreciate it. I spoke at my friend's, and you get good, man. You get really, really good. Like now, and we're talking about this earlier, like, I can prepare for an interview in half an hour and it'll come across like, you know what I mean? Like I haven't.
So yeah, once you do the research, right? As you said, it just flows in your blood already. Yeah. And it's a routine that you've been doing for many years. It's not just given 24 hours or 2 days. You've been doing it for many years. And a lot of people will think about, I can do that. Like, that's what I was going to ask you. Opening your Red Panda 4 years now and working back another 15 more years from your career. Being in the digital marketing industry, there's a lot of digital marketing industry. Mm. In the last 5 years, a lot of things has popped out. That's why I'm asking you, what's the competition like out there? It's like your industry. It's a cutthroat. Yeah. I know that. It's like coming from a telco marketing. I know, I know that the feeling, especially with SEO, digital marketing, and all that stuff, because there's a lot of avenue. So.
Yeah, that's a really good question. And a common friend of ours actually yesterday was talking to me about starting a business, right?
Yep.
And he said, look, can you do some research for me and find out if the figures are there and do some light research? He goes, you know, just a little bit. And I said to him, I said, look, I'll do that. But why are you worried about the competition? If you're good at what you do, why do you care? Like, you should never worry about that. Like, if there's a market you do it. So yes, to answer your question, it is very competitive.
It's very competitive.
But I've done my 10,000 hours.
So he knows that. You know what I mean? See, this is what I like.
Do you love doing this stuff?
I absolutely love
it. But is it the social media or is it the research? Do you love researching stuff? Do you like learning new things?
I love the strategy. And this is the thing, like in digital marketing, in a lot of every industry.
Yeah. You can branch out in digital marketing. That's the problem. Yeah. A lot of people are graduating marketing too. And the good thing about marketing, as I said, there's a lot in one umbrella. There's a lot of, I would say, tentacles. Right, so there's a lot of hands wherever you go. Mm. But where you draw out, I was thinking in my mind, man, you're in a very competitive market.
100%. Well, I don't know if it's the industry. I'm wondering if it's the if he can apply all those techniques and all the things that he's learned to different industries. Can you do that? Like, applying it to
absolutely, because it's the way you think.
That's
right.
So I think it's the more you wait. Yeah,
it's the logic and the approach. So, like, back to your question, the part that I enjoy most about it, and this is the thing. In any industry, almost any industry, I'd say the problem solvers are the ones who generate the money. That's where the value is. Like, to give you a quick example and pivot it back to me in a second, like my brother, he's a web developer. He's a very, very good web developer.
But really, there's a lot of competition out there too.
Yeah, exactly, right. And he's actually quite different. Like, if my dad could have the perfect, because my brother is a pious guy. He's a simple, he's like a hermit. He loves to study. You know, he's
an introvert.
Like a hermit, but he's very peaceful, happy. Like me, if I'm not doing something ambitious, I get anxiety. I go do something ambitious.
Right.
So that's if my dad had the half of him, half of me, he'd be very happy because he'd have the pious. Not that I'm not. I'm very spiritual. And he'd have the ambitious son. But
pious?
Anyway,
what's pious?
Pious, like, you know, like religious.
Oh, okay. Yeah, right.
You know, pray five times a day. I'm a Muslim, obviously. Yeah. I have a Muslim background. You know, like, you know, studying and applying, you know, the religion.
So you're following, yep.
Which I really aspire to. Like, why would I follow something that I don't want to aspire to? Like, I'm just not there where my brother is. But anyway, what I said to my brother, if I can give example, because he'd do one website at a time and he'd charge a couple of grand at a time. I'm like, look, you don't position yourself as a web developer, position yourself as a problem solver. So why don't you get some VAs, you know, in the Philippines or in India, wherever, Get some VAs, take on five projects at a time. And then what you end up being, my brother's name is Omar, you end up being the guy who goes to people who said, look, what problem are you trying to solve? Okay, I understand the problem you're trying to solve from a revenue point of view. This is what you need. Then you delegate the work.
Yep.
Instead of having one project, you're doing five, six, seven at a time. So you know what I'm trying to say?
Project management.
To answer your question, the part I love is I'm solving problems. Yeah. So my job is businesses have problems. And it's not about here's some SEO and here's some social media and here's some posts. No one gives a shit about that.
Yeah.
You're there to solve a problem, right? So what problem are you trying to achieve? What target are you trying to get to? Also, my job is as a strategist. I'm really a strategist, right? So to answer your question, I love the strategy part. This is how you would apply. Now, in regards to your question, will this apply to other industries? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Because if I can distill it in 30 or 60 seconds, my job is to understand my customers and their personas. So their personas are, for example, an industry I'm very familiar with, the equipment hire industry, like Kennard's Hire. They have one type of persona who is the corporate buyer, right? Or a project manager. But then the other persona, like me and you, the DIYers, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So what are the personas you have? How do they make their decision? How do they go from they don't know a business at all?
See, there you go.
Mm. They don't know a business at all. Like they don't know you from bar of soap to all the way become a customer. Now they're an advocate and they're a raving fan.
Right.
So if I can apply that logic of going to a business and saying, who are your personas? How do they make decisions? What questions do they ask in the buyer's journey? And then create content and market. That's marketing. Right. That's all. It's very simple. Yeah. It's not about you. It's not about you how strategize. Good you are. Yeah. That's all it is. So it can be applied to any business on earth.
Yeah. And we will take a short break from our podcast so that Alex can give us some important information.
What up? We are back on the B-Side Word and we have an announcement for you. We would just like for you to give us a bit of attention. That's right. We want you to get onto Instagram, onto Twitter, onto Facebook, and follow us at the B-Side Word. And if you're feeling really, really good, you can leave us a comment, even a like, maybe subscribe to the channel, or even rate us, review us on your favorite podcast listening app. Anyway, back to the episode. Dev?
And back to the podcast.
Now, did you know he fought also in the same banner with me on MMA?
No.
Amateur.
Did we fight on the same night?
No, we didn't same night. The same
December,
night.
2018, December? No.
So when was your last, what year?
2018? It was like December 6th or 9th.
So I was 2019, did you say?
2018.
No, I did mine 20, what are we now, 2020?
2020.
So 2019, July 6th, after your series.
Okay. In Chippendale?
Or? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So you guys both been in the cage?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the chook cage.
Yeah, but like, that's intense, right? That's intense. Like, jiu-jitsu is not, like, especially when you're training, it's not.
It's what you know too, man. Because it's so funny. Like, the reason why I did jiu-jitsu, and Darius knows his story, is I had a striking background. So I did amateur boxing. Nothing great, but I did it 10 years before. So the days I used to miss at Wim to Warrior, because it was 5 days a week,
were
the jiu-jitsu days.
Yeah.
Because striking, when we'd spar, I felt okay. Like, I'm not going to, not some superstar. Yeah. I felt okay because they had never done it before.
You always have the, you know what I mean? You know the funniest thing about it, Moby, before I cut you in? You know when you said that? Everyone had something, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know when they said, oh, we don't have experience. Then I come in, I start sparring. Oh, shit. Okay. Now it's just like, oh, Ernest, huh? You said you don't know anything, huh? He's just like, okay.
People lied about what they knew and stuff?
You're figuring those people out. You're gauging it right now.
Yeah, gauging,
okay,
yeah.
Moby, okay, you said you didn't know shit.
So, like, I'm not going to lie. Like, I not great, but they didn't. And, I've always had a bit of speed. I was always this kind of speed outside guy. But no one there had any boxing experience. Yeah. So I was the best striker with my hands in the entire gym.
Well, you're like, yeah.
But that's not like it good. Yeah. It was just better than someone with no experience.
Right, yeah,
that's
right.
All. So they're the days I enjoyed.
So what made you do it?
Well, they were a client of ours. They were a client of ours for 3 years.
Oh, okay. Weird. What's his name?
Richard Craney.
Richard Craney.
Amazing, amazing guy. Yeah. Richard Craney. Nick Langton.
So when they started back in North Sydney before they having their own, because we Chippendale, because they had Richard Craney had his own gym in North Sydney.
Correct.
When I was working with Voda, so it was just underneath. Then he became a business minded person, right? Stepping back.
Yeah, and he brought in Nick. That commercial.
And I think Nick was the finance industry too. If I could recall, then he had another coach, a female coach. No longer with the company. She was at, but how it started, when I look at it now, it became a global sensation. Yeah. That brand now.
Wim to Warrior?
Yeah.
It's a global sensation.
Oh, yeah. It's in like
Canada, Ireland, US. So they have like UFC coaching.
I wonder if they'll ever have international Wim to Warrior.
That's what they're trying to do.
They've spoken about it. It's difficult now in COVID.
Yeah.
And when we started with them, they had, I don't know, two or three staff. By the time we finished working with them, which was, I think, 2-3 year contract.
Yeah, they have like...
huge. So if you saw an ad, chances are we made it. Like any time in the last couple of
years. There you go.
Wow.
So that made you the...
So you would have saw our ad, Darius.
See, the first season when this was back, because I think they've been running for the last 7 years or more.
Yeah, more.
Yeah,
now.
More.
I'd say
so.
10 years
someone said, Darius, you got to try it. Then said, because I said, look, I already have background in Muay Thai and kickboxing. Yeah. And I said, nah. But then, oh, yeah, you're right. Because I turned 40. I said,
wow, that's brave to do it in your 40s, man.
But I fought a guy that is. Yeah. Yeah. When I turned 40, I said,
because you know you're slower.
Yeah.
You know, the mental play. I'm 33 and I already think, man, I want to have one more fight. But I'm going to think, man, I'm getting old.
Itch.
You know what I mean?
It was the itch. It was the itch that it goes. So I said, look, I could take a beating. I always said, I could take a beating. But when we had sparring, I was like, I'm taking it, right? I said, that's fine. You give one, I give two, whatever it may be. But during the fight, I never had like, I think I weed 16 times.
During the fight?
Yeah, I mean, before the fight.
You weed?
Yeah.
You were that nervous?
Yeah. I don't know if I was nervous or just
drank.
Your stories end up in the toilet.
I know.
Yeah. So,
on the toilet somehow.
So this is the funniest thing. So got into the fight, felt good, did the warm up.
You
know when the warm, you
the
know,
warm up, man,
did you do it the
north?
Did the warm up?
Northeast, you're firing. You feel unstoppable.
I was like, you feel like, you said unstoppable. You feel like the Avengers, right? But in my mind, when close the gate, close the cage, lights out, you felt like it's just blank. Like you see your friends,
stops a little bit.
Yeah. But once the first hit got into my face, I go, fuck, this is real. Well, I said...
But you had fought before.
Yeah.
The
problem was, when he took me down, when he went for a shoot, because remember, I could just like unbox or tie box, we would just blow, right?
Mm.
Strike. But this guy took me down, like a 24-year-old, a 24-year-old against a 40-year-old person.
And he was from your gym too, right?
Yeah.
So he game planned that. He goes, I got to take this guy down.
You know the funniest thing about it? If we're going to load the photos, we had photos. The same technique he did to me twice. I said, fuck, I should know about this.
Yeah.
Right? But for some reason, I was just dumbfounded. Because when you're there...
Stage fright?
No, it wasn't stage fright. All I wanted to do is survive, flight or fight. I was fighting,
yeah,
but it was just too strong. as you said, as you mentioned earlier on, the speed wasn't there.
Yeah.
But my balls was there, but my speed wasn't there.
Yeah.
Speed's right? One of the first things that goes.
Yeah, yeah. Speed wasn't
power, there. Power stays.
I did, yeah. He did the power bomb on me. I didn't feel it. I said the adrenaline. Second, when I felt that, oh crap, after that, I go, shit, I do feel it.
Wait, Moby, so you, when you went into the ring and you got hit the first time, what did you do?
So man, I'll tell you, if I can tell you my experience, and then it circles back to Gracie. So I remember the first round. So because this is the thing, right? I'm a public speaker. I'm not used to crowds. Like most people.
Really?
I'm used to crowds. I'm not scared of crowds.
Okay.
So I'm a public speaker. The people don't bother me. Like that doesn't bother me at all, right? So I went in the mindset. It's like, oh, dude, you speak all. Most people are scared of the people, right? Me too. Like, I'm not going to lie. That's what scares you. I'm going to be embarrassed. You don't care about getting hurt.
Yeah.
You care about getting embarrassed. You don't give a shit about getting hurt, really. You think you do, but you're not. So I went in there relaxed. I'm like, all right, I'm going to play my strength. I'm going to be more relaxed than that guy. And I'm going to go in relaxed. And I was going there. I reckon my heartbeat was not 110. It was probably like less. 90. I was probably pretty relaxed.
Probably too relaxed?
Yes. Yes. That's okay. What happened. So what happened in the first round, I could see that, man, these nerves. It's so funny. You see people, and I'm sure you saw this, Darius. You see people in the gym. They were like very average. But when the fight came on, fight or flight, right? They turned it on. I remember this one girl, she was like this, you know, quiet, small little thing. And she'd cry when she'd get hit in the gym. When it was her fight, she was an animal.
Yeah. She was like beast. Right. Yeah,
she's like, she just went crazy, right?
Right.
So, and she knocked the chick out. So whoa. I took a whole round to warm up. So this guy came in and I could see and he floored me. So he threw this punch. I've never been that hit hard in my life. And going back to a question you said earlier like that, I think every man or woman, especially men, because we're primal, we're a little bit like, we have our egos. Animals every think. Man should fight once in their life. Not you on the street, in a sanctioned fight.
Yeah.
Because you learn something about yourself.
Right.
You push yourself to that edge to see what happens to your emotions.
Yeah,
you learn something about yourself, right? And then you get through the other end and it's like, I've done that now, you know?
So he
punched me. What I learned about myself, I bounced straight back up. I'm like, I'm not dying. I'm not giving up.
Yeah.
So the whole survivor thing, I'm like, and my wife saw me. Everyone said I bounced, like went bang. He hit me with this full thing and I was so relaxed that I didn't even really react to it. Bang and back up.
Like
so,
Tyson Fury.
But not as skilled.
Yeah.
So this guy, and this is the other thing too, man, I would not do Wim to Warrior again because they don't let you cut that much weight.
Wait a minute. Because, okay, when you're doing any fight, you got to drop weight to certain categories. I went from a super lightweight, right? So I haven't been super lightweight for almost 10
lightweight?
Years.
Lightweight? Super lightweight?
Yeah, 10 years.
So what's super lightweight?
Super featherweight. 71.3.
You fought 71.3?
Yeah.
That's what I should have freaking fought.
What did you fight at?
79.
Oh, you were right? Wow! I was
heavyweight,
because,
isn't it?
Because they don't let you cut that much weight. Feather.
So I came from. I started with. So you were at 79.
Yeah,
so,
man.
So you're what, lightweight?
No, like I think that's middleweight.
Middleweight, 79.
Yeah, so, and I'm a small, skinny Pakistani guy.
The funniest thing, right? Going back in, it's not easy.
Yeah.
So I haven't dropped weight for almost 10 years since I competed.
Mm.
Right.
You put in amateur MMA. Amateur MMA.
So there it is. Super welterweight, 70. So this one changes.
It's different to boxing, is it? But it's so like, and every gym's different actually, because actually Tasha, who works with me,
Tasha.
She did it and they let her cut. But Mick, he doesn't let you cut that much.
I started
very, very heavy.
I cut 10 kilos.
Just to give a perspective, when I fought boxing, I fought once at 65.
Yeah. Oh,
Once at 69. I'm a small, skinny, Pakistani frame guy. And so I couldn't cut that much. So the guy who I fought was 6 foot, like he's more than a head bigger than me. And my style is outside.
So,
you know,
I feel you, because when I was in 79 kilos, when I fought kickboxing, 79 kilos, right? The funniest thing about it, because I'm a midget for 79 kilos.
Mm-hmm. 79 kilos?
Yeah, I'm a midget. Dude, you get like 6'1".
Yeah,
right?
Man.
So I fought this, right? I fought kickboxing. This is what happened. So I fought
strong guys too.
No, this guy was 79, 6'2". So when I fought this guy, this prior, right? Then when I was 79. So if I could recall, I brought my missus back then, right? And I got hit in the face really hard. I went down.
Yeah.
I went down on my knee. I tried to get up. It's illegal blow what he did. It was a kick down.
Wow.
So, oh, wow.
So the funniest thing about it, when I got that hit, right? I'll never forget when I got that hit. The competition was based in Richmond Air Base, around that area. I had to drove
so
back.
You took off.
Yeah. I drove back, and because remember, I got literally knocked unconscious. But
right,
yeah, and no one drove me except I drove me and my family.
Yeah.
Oh man, and I thought I was driving 110 kilometers an hour, and apparently I was just driving 10 kilometers on the way.
Oh shit!
Wow. Could someone else not drive?
No one can drive in the family back then.
Yeah, right.
I only had like one kid back then.
Was it this guy?
Tong Po.
Was it this guy?
Okay. Wait. So that was 10 years back. Yeah. So the last time I fought. So I fought last year. So that's 10 years now. So 30 years, so I've turned 40.
Yeah.
So cutting down from 82 to 71 kilos, that's a lot.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was it this guy?
Jean-Claude.
Oh, Jean-Claude.
Tong Po. I remember this. You never seen the kickboxing, the movie?
You never seen Kickboxer?
Man, I don't think I have.
Oh, no.
You
never seen Bloodsport?
None of your friends told you to watch this?
I can't. I'm embarrassed to say that.
You know, like, the funniest thing about it? They did a reboot of this.
Yeah, they did.
I didn't like it. With Dave Bautista as Tong Po.
Look at this guy.
He was hitting the beam of concrete.
Right, is he watching his opponent?
Yeah. Now his brother's opponent.
Yeah, he's the trainer. Van Damme's the trainer here.
That's supposed to be his opponent.
Yeah.
He catches his opponent.
So Tong Po. I'll never forget this. The kickboxer. I'll break you.
It's intense, bro.
It's the acting. Bang. Yeah, you don't watch this stuff for the acting.
So the funniest thing about it, going back. So you didn't drop.
Yeah, so I dropped, I hit the canvas, and I bounced straight back up. So because he's tall, and like, you know, you guys will understand
6'1" or 6'2"?
Who, me?
No, the opponent.
At least 6 foot.
Jeez. At least 6 foot. You're 5'9", like me.
Oh, no, I'm 5'7".
See, I'm...
Yeah. I'm short. Oh, 5'9"? No, 5'9". Sorry, I am 5'9". Yeah, 174. Yeah, sorry.
5'9", 5'8", right?
5'9".
So think about it this. So if you didn't drop 79 kilos, and the guy's 6'1".
He had no fat on him. I still had a gut.
See, that changes. His power and his strength changes no matter what. I never been dropped down 71.3 till my whole life.
Like, you must have felt weak, but you know when you cut, I felt great. Right?
Yeah, but it's depending on your natural body.
It wasn't
right?
my walking weight.
Yeah, your natural
my
body.
My walking weight was 75 all the time.
Or what your walking weight should be. Because like if you start fat, so Wim Tuara is amazing. It's amazing. But the thing is, I will say like, it's one of the, if I was fighting amateur MMA and I was 79, I'd say firstly, the coach won't put me in.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd say, you know what? I'm going to go down a weight class.
Yeah.
Why would I do that to myself?
Yeah.
So it took me one whole round because, like I said, my style was always that stick and move, like
just
the boxing style.
Just jabbing outside.
Not a brawler. Yeah. Stick and move, fast. So it took me a whole round. And then when I went back to the corner and I thought, man, I have to just bite down on my mouth guard and just fight messy, which is not my style. Like brawler, messy inside, messy boxing. It's not my style, but I did it. And I came out and I won that second round. So I just
went
to
the third round.
Went to the third round.
Wow.
And for anyone who doesn't know this, in amateur, it's not like boxing. In amateur MMA, because in boxing, I think you get 3 rounds.
Yeah, in 2 minutes. Yep, 90.
In amateur MMA, it's 2 rounds only. Yep. 2 rounds only.
But there's a decision.
100%.
So
they
get
very excited. Yeah. So the coach is like, they want that for whatever reason, because they're just evil. They want that, right? So it's like, you know, they get excited. Third round. And I knew it was going to be third round, but I swear when I was sitting there, I'm like, man, you know, if I've lost this, I didn't care. I'm done. Like, I'm so exhausted. I'm done, right?
Right.
They came to me and they're like, oh, third round. And my eyes were like, oh, I want to give up. But my mouth would never let me
See,
say
this,
that.
This
I would never
happened.
Say that.
To be honest with you, I didn't want, in my mind,
yeah.
when I got caught, right? This guy, the kid that I fought, nice guy. One of the nice guy. I thought he was like...
Yeah, they're all nice until...
They were one of the nice guys. Even when we spar, we nice guy when we talk, right? And he's only here on a, I think... He was a backpacker. So yeah. He was good. He's from Wales. Everyone thought he was a McGregor lookalike, right? So the first, he took me like, you know, the movie, the cartoon He-Man? You know, when he pulled his sword?
He-Man!
Yeah, he did the He-Man. He just lift me like that and body slam. So he didn't feel, But the second one, dude, I felt there was a jolt from all the way.
Oh, shit, bro.
From the back, right? So, but my mind said it's a flight or fight. I said, I'm not gonna never going to give up on this. I was still fighting. I was still hitting. But I didn't realize my left was numb. Like, this was open. So it was told, the guy was hitting here. And the ref goes, we're going to stop this. If you're not going to cover yourself. Oh, what do you mean stop it? I'm fighting.
Are you talking to the ref while you're getting hit?
Yeah, I'm fighting. I'm talking it's to the guy. Bad, man. I'm talking to the guy. You still want to go? Yeah, let's go.
Yeah. Some
ref goes,
1, 2, 3, that's it.
More. It was like bang, bang. Then I realized after the effect, it was lumps everywhere.
Oh, shit.
So in my mind, don't give up.
Yeah.
But my physical body is already out of there.
It's over. Yeah.
It's over.
But you learn something about yourself and you have to go through that.
But going back into that, should I fight again? I would, man. After that, I went to Asia, Japan Open. So I went to Japan Open. It just made me more after. So the fight was Saturday. Monday, I was back in the gym.
Crazy, bro.
I just went because I felt. Yeah, but my body wanted, okay, I can do more. Yeah. I can do better.
In the third round we went and I went back to, because this is why you know this, Darius, because you're a trainer. You have to train things because you always fall back to your training.
Right.
You just go back to your instincts.
Yeah.
So I just went back to my boxing instincts. So I was chasing him around the cage. I was doing well. I was winning the round because he's so tall. And I couldn't do what he did to me. I actually took him to the cage. Now, what I know now with jiu-jitsu, I would have taken him down, right? But I didn't know that then. And my head was in, you know, boxing? Boxing's very different. In boxing, you can put your head in their chest and go for it, right? But you do that in MMA or jiu-jitsu. No, well, he guillotined me, right?
Take it down.
He just bent over. He just guillotined me. And I didn't know how to get out of it. Like, now I know I could have done a von Flute when we fell down. But I couldn't get out of it. And then after that, I'll tell you what I did. I was depressed for 2 days.
Afterwards.
Oh, were you depressed?
Yeah, I was depressed. I'm not going to lie. I was depressed that Saturday and that Sunday. I was upset. And my wife actually left me. You know what I mean? She's like, you know what? He's probably too... I'm just leaving with his thoughts. 2 days, I was depressed. I was like not happy. And I was...
It's the ego that will hit you.
You know, people think, I run a business. I'm very confident. I'm really, really hard on myself I'm really hard on myself. But I'm an extreme personality. I was depressed for 2 days. Then on Monday, I'm like, all right, stuff this. I'm going to join a jiu-jitsu. I lost from jiu-jitsu. I need to figure this sport out. And now that is the story behind why I went to Gracie Parramatta.
Pause the podcast.
Okay, if you are listening on your phone, pick it up right now. Go onto your Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, get us at the B-Side Word. And did you know that we actually record these with video as well? And you can find us on YouTube, again, at the B-Side Word. And we would love it if you subscribe. You can leave us some comments. We love to engage. And you know what? Let me ask you this. If you do follow us on any of these already, what is it you would like to see from us? Leave us some comments. Let us know.
Oh, what he said.
What he said. Subscribe.
I can't say the word for some reason.
Subscribe.
Unpause the podcast. I want to ask Moby. So you said you said a few times like everyone should get hit, right? And see what you're made of and stuff. I think the only time I got hit was in jiu-jitsu and someone did accidentally. So they're trying to do a move and they kicked me in the face and I went, I don't like this. I don't like
it. Yeah, it's because you weren't expecting it, right? Because you weren't expecting it. But when you go into that environment where you're going to expect it, and it's not even like, and I do want to say one thing to preface that as well. Like, because I don't want people to think, oh, yeah, I'll go in to find out myself. Maybe I'll get exposed. No, no, it's not about that. The act of you trying, you're going to come out of this stronger. Like the fact that you want to test yourself and go, and I think every man, especially in their youth, utilize your youth, have a freaking sanctioned fight. Like do something like Wim Tawara where it's controlled, you match with your same opponents.
Or even a PCYC boxing.
Have the best programs.
In fact, that's what I'm
thinking. Do that. Yeah.
I'm thinking about it right now. I was looking at it to do a PCYC boxing, right? Because I said, well, let's try.
Have you done boxing, amateur boxing before? So having done amateur boxing and MMA, I actually firmly believe that MMA is much safer. I firmly believe it's much safer because you're spreading the load.
It's
right?
just not one area.
It's just not your head. And especially you're in your 40s. We're professionals. We work with our heads, right? I would more readily now go into MMA, even though I love boxing. It's my first love in combat sports. Than boxing.
So
you're spreading the load. And you can use jiu-jitsu. You know, you can do a Habib and take people down. You know what I mean? Like, you can spread that, you know? It's not just straight to your head, which is not good, man. Like, I love boxing.
So my question to you, because we've mentioned this in the last podcast, Mike Tyson and Roy Jones are fighting in their prime 50s. Oh, I would
so
say
funny
prime.
To say that, yeah.
So in their prime.
Darius is four, and I'm against it.
So are you against or?
So who's for it? You're for, and you're against it. So it's so interesting you said this.
Because the reason why I like it, because think about it, how many well-known names out there in the boxing industry? Yeah, there are, but not like these guys where when we grew up. But like when we hear Mike Tyson, he was the real beast.
Roy Jones too, don't forget.
Yeah, Roy Jones.
Y'all must have forgot. You know what I mean?
That's what I said. Mike Tyson, Roy Jones, Evander Holyfield, Lennox Lewis, before Pacquiao and them, right? Yeah. Before Pacquiao,
oh,
De La Hoya.
Man,
we could talk about this. But now they're in the 50s. One's 54, one's 52. That's it, mate. It's in their DNA.
What are you talking about, man?
It's in their
DNA. 50. Listen. Look, they were champions. They'll always be champions.
They're legends.
They don't have to prove anything. They don't have to punch each other in the head. They want to have a fight? Play chess. Right? Don't fucking hit each other in the head.
People want this.
I don't give a shit.
Yeah,
like,
people want this.
Like when the 12 rounds are finished, right?
Then
the people,
eight rounds, I think, in this
like
one.
You remember when you went in the car?
Which
and
car?
You drove yourself after the fight?
Yeah.
It's them. It's him and his family going to go home. That's it. You know what I mean?
But they made millions, brother. That's the good thing about it.
It doesn't matter if you can't do anything with it. It's for me, like, I don't.
So would you watch the fight?
I enjoy. I'm not watching it. You know Manny Pacquiao? I'm scared for him now. This is where I'm at with Manny Pacquiao. He has been in so many epic fights. I love him to death. He's done so much for the country.
The wars,
he's done so much for the boxing.
Yeah.
Even boxing, when boxing was going through a lull, Manny Pacquiao was like the highlight. Like he was bringing it up. He wasn't afraid to fight anyone, right? But now when I saw him get knocked out, I'm like, he's not there. The killer instinct's not there anymore.
No,
like
he's still.
It's not there. As soon as he found, like when he went into politics and then when he went hardcore into his religion, he lost it.
What
he
are you saying?
It.
You should go back to hookers and gambling.
Yes.
It's like that Rocky movie. Man, success makes you soft.
It does.
I'm in my 30s now. I've got kids. It makes you softer.
Yeah.
Like it's not
the same. It's not the same when you're growing up, like when you have to fight to eat. He had to fight to feed his family.
Sell your dog and he had to sell his dog or something.
It's true, like, is that a true story from Manny Pacquiao?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
I think he had to sell his dog or
the
something.
The Kid Kalafu like, movie.
He had to do something brutal. He's selling matches, you know? So, yeah.
It's different.
So, going back to that, are you against or regarding about the current fight with Mike Tyson and Roy Jones, or are you in favor that they're going through?
This is the thing. If you understand their mindset, you will understand why they're doing it. If you understand their mindset, I don't want to get into the Jordan Last Dance. We can hit that topic later. But when you watch that, and also like you learn what they're made of, that never goes away, man.
No,
you know, like
I get it.
If you push him by accident, it's like, man, I got to put it over you. You need to be obsessive to have a champion mindset. You have to.
You can't just turn it off.
Or develop
it.
And that's the thing.
You can't
you
just
cannot
turn it off.
Turn it off. Unfortunately,
like
that's
not
what
like
makes
a switch.
Champions.
I agree with you when you have that mindset. Did you watch the Joe Rogan podcast with him on there?
You know, it's funny you say that. It's funny you asked me about that because I was listening to the Roy Jones one.
Yeah.
I think even on the way here, I'm halfway through it. And you learn something. It's that mindset is exactly the same. So he's older. He looks older.
Wiser.
But he's exact. It's like, man, I'm a champion. I'm going to win. Like, this is who I am. This is the DNA. This is what I'm made
for. So remember, so if you said, if you listen to JRE's regarding, not Roy Jones, Mike Tyson.
The Tyson one, yeah.
So the first one, right? There's two. The first one, when he said, I'm over boxing, you know, I got my new career, you know, the weed business and also family man now. The second one, he goes, oh man, it's not me. It's the war of God summons me. It's just one.
He said, sometimes you don't know what trigger it is. Like,
but he goes, he hates coming to this boxing right now. He dropped all the smoking weeds because he's into his mindset. Like, I'm going to be an athlete once again.
He's on a mission.
I'm going to be on a 6 months journey. No drugs, no whatever it may be, no booze, no drinks. Just focus on training.
And you know what triggered it? You know what triggered it? His wife said, you're getting fat.
It's true.
That's it. That's what triggered it.
You know what started? I'm going to do the 5 kilometer run on a treadmill. That's when he started. When he said
5 minute or whatever.
Or something and like 5 kilometers. Then suddenly, you know what? I'm going to do 10 kilometers. You know what? I'm going to do 12 kilometers. He started pushing himself. You know what? Let's do this.
Yeah.
But going back to that, when he did pad works with the trainer, that 30 seconds video, he was laughing. Because when Mike Tyson said, oh, whatever.
Was laughing.
Yeah. Because we're going back to this. Let me go back.
Mike Tyson, I wasn't laughing.
So when Mike Tyson did the video, the 30 seconds pad work with Cordero, right? So when he had the interview with Joe Rogan, he goes, oh, Joe, that 30 seconds video, that literally killed me. I couldn't walk. I couldn't walk. Yeah. I couldn't get in bed for a week.
Yeah.
And they have to, they have to jab some medicine to me. Okay, so whatever you've seen in that video that I was hammering at, I couldn't get up for 1 week in my bed.
Yeah.
Wow, it looks.
I wasn't laughing at the video. Yeah. I was laughing at the aftermath. Like, I couldn't move. I'm like, oh.
Because everyone was go get up. Oh, I said, no, I can't get up. My body's gone. They have to ring up the I think the current wife's a doctor also. So he goes, get the specialist. We'll jab something. You know, so he goes, but now they're in a mission, man.
Wait, so what is, so
see,
so championship, the cancer, yes.
Championship mindset.
No, of course, I, because they want to do it. Like that mindset doesn't go away.
Yeah.
It doesn't go away. So when Roy Jones was young, he went from middleweight to heavyweight, right? Like everyone knows what he did. And then he went back down so he could capture the lightweight. And when he was at heavyweight, he said the only person he was going to fight, so he talks
Mike
about
Tyson,
this in the JRE now, that it was going to be Tyson.
It never happened,
It didn't happen. So he's got that opportunity. And the way he's looking at it is like, look, and he fought a couple of years ago, and some of the fights Roy Jones had, like he got knocked out by Danny Green, which is like, man.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. I never saw that one. He should not have fought, man. That fight I'm not for. Yeah. You know, that fight I'm not for. Him going against, or like Pacquiao going against young, hungry lions, I'm not for
Why
that,
not?
Man.
Why not?
I became more Filipino watching that guy. I followed him through everything.
No, it just showed him that Pacquiao, because a lot of people denied Pacquiao doesn't have the speed, doesn't have the agility, doesn't have the coordination, doesn't have
You can't fight. But you can't fight time. You can't fight
watch
time.
Watch every fight that he had, the strategy that he had, the power.
Foreman beat his face. He won the fight, but Pacquiao got hit so many times. Previous to that fight, he was 30 years old. Thurman.
Yeah.
I watched the highlights, right? I just remember, and it brought me back to the time when I was watching
it. Fight.
It doesn't matter, D, you're not listening. Like when he was fighting previous to that, punches were rolling off him. He was moving.
Yeah.
The punches are hitting straight in the face now.
It's just too fast
for
him.
I can see in his eyes, he goes, I gotta.
He should have,
I went to watch him in Queensland when he came. Who did he fight against?
Horn. I was there.
That was a raw. 100%
no,
it
was. Wasn't.
100%.
I'm always against Pacquiao, right? So
you're always against him?
Yeah, all my fight that I bet on Pacquiao, against Pacquiao. Yeah. And I made money.
Yeah.
So when went against
you Pacquiao. You never made money.
I made money against
just
Pacquiao.
Once?
No, Marquez.
Marquez and Horn.
Horn. The other guy who had to fight twice.
Wait. So the three people that you bet against, you won.
Yeah.
How about the other times?
Nah, fuck.
You lost.
So old Pacquiao would have smashed Horn. Yeah. It wouldn't have gone to that.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have gone to the judges. That's the point I'm trying to make.
The 12 rounds. Yeah.
And like, I love watching fights live because it's like, you don't see the camera shutter. Like, somehow you absorb it more.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So like, even that fight, I'm like, okay, I believe he won. But old Pacquiao would not.
Yeah, he wouldn't have gone to that point.
So I agree with you. Now, with these guys, though. But
they're the same age.
They're the same age.
The same speed, yeah.
They're old. They're same age. They're of the same class.
Yeah.
They will be fine.
Right.
They're going to be fine. You know what I mean? They want to. So when you understand, you might not agree with it, but you can understand
I can understand it. There's definitely, I can understand.
It's that mindset that will never go away.
The mindset that
they
have.
It's just like two lions now. Very old ones at the top of the rock.
You know what it teaches us? That to be successful at any level of eliteness, you must be obsessive to the point where people say, dude, there's something wrong. You're a bit crazy.
Like
Jordan, right? Jordan, man, like, let's admit it. There's something wrong with him.
Like Kobe.
If I slight you, I'm like, oh, hey, nice one, Darius. And if that's Jordan, he's like, he's going to have the best game he had all season next time because I said that.
Yeah.
That's not normal. Like, bro, something.
Did you hear about him with Jordan?
Like, take a chill pill.
I know, right? But did you hear his motivation? Like, he makes up stories to beat you. So he's like,
it's his competitive mindset.
Yeah, but to the point where he makes up a story about, like, so if he's like, Moby said, hey, Jordan, he goes, this guy
like
stole
how
my.
How dare he do that?
Well, he's
below
like,
me.
Moby stole my lollipop.
So the last, there was an
episode. Like, he'll make up something in his head to go, I've got to beat this guy because he made me look like a fool.
What does that tell you? You have to keep that narrative because you have to motivate yourself.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the point is, you have to get to a point of obsessiveness where it is weird. It is like a friend of mine who, and he actually worked for me, and he unfortunately he committed suicide a couple of years ago.
It was
a very, very, very tragic end, right? So like, you know, I'm thinking about him now, but you know, amazing guy. Before he worked with me, he ran his own business. And he said something to me very interesting. Have you ever seen people run successful businesses and they're just complete dropkicks and idiots? And you're like, how the hell are you running a business, right? So not that my friend Richard, may God bless his soul, not that he's an idiot, but he said something to me that was very humbling from his part. Because I remember asking him about his first business, how he did so well. He goes, you know what? He goes, I think it's the fact I was so dumb. If I was any smarter, I would have realized that this is stupid. I would have given up.
Right.
See what I'm trying to say? He said, if I was any smarter, I would have given up. But I'm so dumb and stubborn, I just kept going with it and it became successful.
Wow. Because he had this man.
You know what I'm trying to say? So sometimes we're too intelligent for our own good. It's like why would I do this? Why would I do this? This
is stuff.
Obsessive. You know, when I started my business, I didn't just start it. I worked 5 days a week for someone. Then I'm like, okay, I need to take this seriously. I work 4 days a week.
Yeah.
And then I told my wife, listen, from now on, just so I don't disappoint you and I don't let you down because I can't have that feeling of guilt, Saturdays now are gone. Count me out on Saturdays. I'm working on Saturdays. You know, just so I don't keep letting you down, just know, and for the next 2 or 3 years, let's say 2 years, let's be conservative, I had no Saturdays. Right. So what I do, I've 4 days a week. Then I worked 3 days a week. And what I do, I'd wake up 5 o'clock in the morning. Do all this work, 4 hours of work, and then I was you know, being kind of cheeky. Then I didn't want my clients to think Moby only sends emails 4 o'clock. He's not running an actual business. I would schedule my emails so they go out at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 3:35, random times.
Okay.
And then at lunch, I'd go and work. I'd go to McDonald's, get some Wi-Fi, and work.
Right.
Come home and work.
That's a hustle.
Then I did the 5 days and 3 days and 2 days. Then it gets to a point, and this is what I recommend everyone do. It gets to a point where there's a friction, where you feel like you're letting down your employer, but you're also letting down your business.
Right.
That's when you make the jump. You're like, okay, now I've got to invest, to take that plunge. Now it's a calculated risk because I've got that journey and that track record. So that is obsessive. I would do that, and it's work Saturdays, and on Sundays do the podcast, and Monday to Friday. Like, it's crazy, but you have to.
You must
do things that people say, man, something is a little bit wrong with you.
I like it.
What motivates you every day? What motivates you?
Well,
to me, because okay,
yeah,
answer
the thing is, you know, if the Jordan thing teaches us something, your motivation must change over time.
Evolve.
It must change over time. So to answer that question, they say that when you consider happiness, which is honestly, that is the aim for us. Not to be rich, because rich does not equate happiness. But when, and people much smarter than me, speaking of TED, I think this came from a TED talk. I can't remember who it was for the life of me, but he said, when they look at the studies of people and they find happiness, like, you know, is it money? Money has nothing to do with it. Nothing. Yeah, yeah. The two main factors are, one, gratitude, being grateful and actively being grateful. And, you know, like if you're religious or you do your prayers, then you can use that. If you don't, meditating and journaling, that sort of stuff. Practice. And the second thing, which is really, really important, is connecting your goals to a higher purpose. Right. So, or a higher cause, right? So it could be, you know, giving back to the community. It could be, maybe could be religious. It's something that's connected to beyond you.
Can I ask? So I believe what you're saying. But are you able to do that if you're not financially stable?
Why not?
Because like if you're not financially stable and you don't have like somewhere to live, or you haven't got enough time to eat,
right?
If you haven't got food, or you can't.
Do you need
to reach a certain level before you can go beyond that?
So, you know, in psychology and consumer behavior, you might know this, Darius, they talk about Maslow's hierarchy of needs.
Yeah.
Maslow hierarchy.
And our basic need is food, shelter, sex, you know, like the basic. What animals have, essentially, right? Yeah. What animals have the needs that we have: shelter, food, water, hunger. Of course, you need to fulfill those needs. Yeah. Of course, like you must fulfill that basic need. But that's the thing, man. People confuse that with other things. You just need a place to live and food. And in Australia, it's not difficult, man, to work at Macca's, Uber, like do something.
There's always something there.
Just to earn some money, just to survive.
Yep.
Not go out and like every weekend and have fun. Just to survive. It's just not difficult.
Yeah, 100%.
Can I cut you in? Going back to your teacher, that you saw basking.
Yeah, Mr. Zab.
Yeah, the guy just gave up and just followed his heart, being basking around. He's happier.
Yeah, he's happier. Yeah, I saw him on the street and he was basking, and I said, he was playing, right? And I said, he stopped his set and I went, Mr. Zab. And he looked at me and he freaked out. He goes, I haven't been called that in 10 years, right?
But that's your teacher.
That's my teacher. Wow, yeah, our teacher, right? And I said, how you been? And he goes, I don't recognize. I go, Delaney College. Mm. And he goes, oh, like he said, shit. Mm. He's like freaking out. And he goes, man, how are you? He goes, I go, what have you been doing? He goes, I've been busking for the last 10 years. I said, You're making a good living? He goes, yeah, I'm making a living, but I'm so happy. Yeah. I was like, wow.
So it's crazy. So money doesn't buy happiness, I guess.
Well, so to answer your question, and this might seem, and I don't think I've ever said this publicly, but for me, it's like you have to have crazy, crazy, crazy goals, right? Like it's almost, but I'm going to say it. Like, you know, let's sort of be vulnerable here. Let's sort of say it. If I became prime minister of this country, I would die a very happy man.
Wow.
And even if I don't get there, and it's not about being prime minister. Firstly, I think, you know, to be in office, my opinion is you must give back for like 10, 20 years before you have the right to even call yourself.
So why not be a council?
But it's not necessarily the art of being a prime minister. It's giving back to my community. Like so many young people, I'm so, so fortunate. I had a very, very good mentor and she's still a bit of my mentor. And a shout out to Manel. I don't even know if she's going to be listening to this, but I'll share it with her. But I was very lucky to, at a young, impressionable age, to have a mentor who helped me with my career. And I meet young people and I hire young people so many times. And I'm like, man, if you had a little bit of guidance, sometimes you need people to believe in you before you can believe in yourself. And I had that.
Yeah, nice.
So for me, I want to give back to the community. I want to give back to people and get them to realize that they can actually achieve. Specifically, I want to help all people, right? All people who are trying to achieve something. But specifically, first and foremost, the Muslim community. Mm. Because what happened with the Muslim community is, unfortunately, after 9/11 and everything that sort of happened, it's kind of like the whole, you're a terrorist, you're scum. Okay, I guess I'm a scum. I guess I'm a hood. Like I have to be a gangster. I have to be this. I'm never going to be out of it. So my whole thing is, and I've done it once or twice and I need to do it more, where it's like, and it's not even about being Muslim. Some people have a chip about being a female in a corporate environment. Some people have a chip about, you know, I don't know, you know, anything. Maybe they're gay, right? Whatever it is. They have this chip.
Yeah.
So like, I want to inspire, motivate people to sort of say, you know what, that chip that you have, park that to the side, and you know, like, you can achieve what you want to. But here's the thing as well. I will never, ever, ever be one of those pretenders. You know, one of those people, you know, like business coaches, one of the most common things, a business, often they failed their business, so they thought they'll be a business coach.
Right.
It is so common. It's a joke. It's so fun. It's not even funny anymore.
Right.
I'm going to be business coach. I don't want to run my business. I'll tell other people how to run a business.
Now you've said business coach.
I will never, ever be that person.
Can I ask you, so how did you overcome your chip?
You know what? My opinion is, and I've heard this from other people, you never completely lose the chip. Right. Like, so because like the thing, I'm very, very different to my parents as well. Like this drive and ambition that I have, it didn't come to my parent from my parents either. Like, my parents did the best thing that they did for me. But you know, this whole chip of, oh, I'm not good enough, I'm Pakistani, I'm Muslim, you know, will people to sort of take me seriously? How I overcame it, to be honest with you, man, is I had a really good mentor.
Right.
I had my passion, and I'm like, okay, I got to do well in this passion. And a mentor just needs, and I see this, I've mentored people now. If someone has a spark, just a spark, I can pour lighter fluid on it.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah, they need to have a spark. And I've tried to motivate people who I'm like, why can't I motivate them? And you realize, if there's no spark, you can put whatever fuel you want. Nothing's going to happen.
It just, it gets a bit wet.
You know, it just gets a bit wet, and that's it. Like, before I even can become in a position of influence, before I even, you know, think about running for office or giving back to the community or whatever, I will never be that pretender. So, you know, like they asked Muhammad Ali, they're like, you know, they always tried to catch him. They're like, oh, you claim to be pious, a good guy, but you're rich and whatever. He said, when you go to the Queen's house, you dial this bell, it goes dong, 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 dong. You're like, oh, wow, someone important must live here. The Queen doesn't open the door. A servant does. They take you to one room, right? And then they take you from another room to another room. By the time you meet the Queen, it's so revered. And he used to say, he goes, if I drive like a shitbox, people aren't going to respect me.
That's
so correct. I do want to be successful. I want the McLaren. I want the big house. I want that sort of stuff. That's not the stuff that makes me happy. I'm happy on my journey. You have to enjoy the journey. But I want that because, for some whatever reason, people will respect you and listen to you when you have the nice watch, the nice car, whatever. They're like, ah, okay. And if that's the gateway for them to listen to me, so be it.
Yeah, right.
No one's
going
to listen to some bum, you know, who hasn't achieved anything, and I'm never going to be that. So I need to, you have to earn something first. Like, what's your path?
Yeah, earn your
stride. Once I have that path, make sure, then I'm in a position for people to listen to.
So you're just gaining clout and then like, that cookie.
Yeah,
that
you
cookie
could call it. Yeah. I mean, the clout comes as a result, but you have to have a path and a journey in a story. Yeah. Like Gary Vee, I could say something to you, right? And Gary Vee could say the exact same thing, but it has much more resonance and much more weight if Gary Vee says it because he's achieved that status. And like, I'm on that journey and I'm happy with that journey.
Mm.
Like, I'm happy with that. I'm speaking more. I'm doing these things. I'm finally getting paid to speak. Right. You know what I mean? So like,
because that's what you love. You're passionate about it. That's...
Yes, yeah. I say prime. That's the kind of like a dream career. But my dream, like, you know, I'd love to get to, because even in marketing, right? People like influencers that no one else knows outside of the marketing world. So really, really small influencers. Even them, they get paid $50,000 to talk, about $10,000 to talk.
It's not bad. It's not a bad gig.
$10,000 to do a keynote at a big marketing conference, right? If you're at the top of the marketing chain, so that's pretty cool. Like, that's a dream for me. My kids will go, like, I became a young dad. My kids will be gone. Me and my wife will just go city to city. I'll do a bunch of gigs, you know. I'm the kind of person, I'll get bored. I always have to do something.
Right.
But for me, like, I was saying, literally come driving here, you know, I was saying to my employees, like, they're like, oh, well, you know, what's happening on the weekend? I'm like, man, I had this meeting in Terry Hills, and I'm like, I'm going to end it with, you know, podcast with some friends. And I'm like, for me, that's like the best way to end. And she's like, aren't you tired? I'm like, no. I get excited and energized. I could have zero sleep. I get excited and energized by talking about things like this, about passion.
Man, it doesn't happen that often. Like I when I was growing up, I don't know. For me, anyways, you get a bunch of guys and you sit in a car. You got your red peas. You sit in a car and you just chat all night, right? And the older you get, you lose sight of that. You lose sight of the relationships that you built, right? Because you focus. Your focus starts to, you start earning a bit money and you start, you know what, I want to start buying this. And all of a sudden your friends start to disappear and you're more focused. You're like, you get your family, your life changes, all this stuff. And like, I was sitting down and I was like, I miss having chats with people. Like, the way I communicate with people is through the phone or on Facebook. I like a post and I'm like, shit, I haven't really talked to anyone in ages. And like, and I was looking at my wife and I said, I don't even talk to you that much. What the hell? So me and my wife do a podcast, right? And like, it's specifically just to get her communicate, to communicate, right? And that's helped in other areas of my life.
It's good. That's good. Right? That's good to hear.
And that was the whole point of the podcast. It was to like get the conversation happening again within people that I know. Like, and like, I don't know how many people I know, but I don't know anything about them.
And who
like,
they are.
I go, this guy's interesting. But I'm never going to talk to him.
But even the way life is now, you know, I would wager, I guess, that most people have less than 5 close friends, like close heart-to-heart friends. You know what I mean? Like, I've got a bunch of friends, I'd say 2-3 of them who are my close friends, like, who, if I don't know them from high school, I've known them for some time. But that's life, though. You go through those cycles.
Yeah.
And when you have kids, then you tend to have friends who also have kids. It's just the cycle of life. And you realize that at some point, you know?
Going back what you just mentioned, reminiscing, and we'll try to, like, all my high school friends or even primary friends that I grew up with, we'll try to get together 3 months. So I said, I understand, you know, we're all busy. But especially now, it's like when COVID hit, there's always, I said, look, we need to catch up because...
Have you noticed that during COVID? You've started to catch up with people that...
I think because we're yearning that connection again.
So it became...
The void of that has forced us to sort of try to feel that. You know what I mean? Which is cool, man. I'm really grateful for... I'm really happy. Like, man, the people, of course, but, you know, taking a good situation out of a bad situation... I think, like, for me, COVID's been good for my soul.
It showed up a lot of things, this COVID, you know, to be grateful for what you have. Because the Zoom, I never spoken to some of these guys 10 years. And suddenly we had a Zoom connections. Then out of the blue, hey, let's go meet up. Let's go in the pub or whatever.
Mm.
Wow. I said, this is good. You know, I said, I never met your kids. You know, I never met your family. But it's good in the same time. So it's reconnecting to the... To those guys.
Yeah.
So happy.
We're going to take a quick break so that Maxi can give us a message.
Hello. Right, if you have Instagram, if you have Facebook, if you have YouTube, if you have Twitter or any other podcasting platform, search for The B-Side Word on any of these platforms and you will find us. And please engage, like, follow, subscribe, do all those things. It'll really help us grow. We really appreciate the love and we enjoy getting your feedback. So go do that. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the show.
But going back into that, now on the lighter side, I don't know if is that an NBA? No, it's not an NBA.
No, it's actually baseball. Go to your question. I don't know watch baseball, by the way, but anyway.
Did you watch the NBA finals?
I didn't. I watched The Last Dance. I've seen one one basketball game my entire life.
Live
and an actual, and that was at New York when I went with my wife.
The Knicks, wow!
I'll just go watch the Knicks. And,
an experience.
That's the only time.
Okay,
I have to admit, but I need to get.
But
into
the
it.
Last Dance, okay, going back in the Last Dance. So, your opinion, was it about the Chicago Bulls or about Michael?
It's about Michael,
it's
man.
It's about Michael.
It's about Michael.
It's not about... Dude, how they portrayed it.
Yeah.
Or it's about the Chicago Bulls, It's all about Michael.
Man, you could do one on... the mini stories, like the ones on that's Rodman. And like, he goes away to Vegas for like 2 days. He comes back and he plays. Man, legendary stuff, man. But yeah, it is. It's about Michael.
Because they portrayed it, it goes, it's about the team, the Chicago Bulls, being the last year of being together. I said, oh, this is great. Nah, it was about Michael.
Yeah.
So that's why I didn't like about it. That's why I think I didn't finish the whole episodes.
Now, you know what? And I think I liked it because I think it's different things for different people. People who are into drama would have seen the drama side. People into whatever would have seen, you know,
because
whatever.
Because when Horace Grant, power forward, mentioned, he goes, that wasn't real. You know, it never happened. He had this, he portrayed something. He goes, that didn't happen, you know. He never came. Then another former teammate, he goes, we never did drugs. We never did this, you know. And it annoyed him. So, but going back to that, he said it wasn't about the Chicago Bowl. It was about Michael. He just...
And that's cool. Like, the way I'm built, I just look for examples in things, yeah. Right? And we're talking about this earlier. Like, when I watched it, I'm like,
oh, he was a perfectionist, man. He was a perfectionist.
It teaches you things. Yeah, it teaches you.
What showed me about Michael on that one when you just mentioned, you know, being the championship
obsessive,
mindset.
Yeah.
You know, when he was, prior to the game, with his security, they were just playing, I don't know, it wasn't a card game. It was just closest to...
The wall, yeah. Some throw, something.
Dude, he was very... He said, he'll beat you. He'll make sure he'll beat you. Because he doesn't... Because losing $20 for a bet, he was annoyed about it. Mm. He was just so much competitive. He talked about the gambling, about on golf, you know. He could lose a lot of money, card games. He just wants... In every game that he has to be number one.
Yeah. Do you want to be like that?
Nah. Not like that.
You know, it depends. It depends on how you're built. If you try to do that, that's a failure for, like, a recipe for failure, right?
I don't know, but his mindset was different.
It's fine. Like, it's figuring out who you are as a person and what motivates you. And like, some people must be challenged. Some people have to be told what to do. Some people seek inspiration from, you know, other means. So I don't want to be like that either. But like, you can take the good and leave the bad. Like, for me, it's like, it's a reminder of that. Of that pursuit where other people will think it is actually actually too much obsessive, that it is what it is, right? But the other thing too, and then you spoke about this earlier, which I really, really liked what I learned, because I learned something from this that I hadn't seen from other entrepreneurs or whatever. And you asked me about this before, Darius, is that motivation, like what motivates you, what you learn about him is when you operate at that level, you have to continually motivate yourself.
Yeah, it doesn't switch off.
It's like, even though he's the elite of the elite, he still had to water that motivation garden. That doesn't turn off. That continues
to
go.
I read about it. As a champion mindset, it's not just like a switch. We don't switch off. It's always there. We're always climbing up. That's why I think Michael Jordan's just never going to stop to be number one. From a business point of view, from a competitive whatever, even though he's 50 plus, I guess, right now, he's always still competing. If someone always goes, let's go one-on-one, even on the camp, like I've seen some videos that the kid goes, we'll do a 5x5 shootout. If you miss one, you're going to pay, you're going to provide everyone's Jordan shoes. Dude, he never miss. This guy, I go, wow.
So you're in a maze of Michael Jordan.
I'm amazed, but in the same time, when I watched The Last Dance, I thought it was going to be the team itself. But it became more, because when I was growing up, I'd watch all these video, right? So the first one, I don't know what was the first one, but the air up there.
Yeah.
It was all about him. So I know what kind of attitude, mental attitude that he had. But I wanted to know the cohesiveness of a team. I thought I was going to know about Scottie Pippen.
Oh, so you were disappointed with it sounded like you're very disappointed.
Oh, yeah. But when that came out, there's another came out with an interview with Kobe. The Black Mamba, that was great, because he goes how I'm motivated, I will challenge myself, I'll be here making sure, just on shooting around in one spot, having like, I'll do 100 shot. If I get 75 out of 100, that's perfect for me.
You know, like
it's a perfectionist.
Yeah, I don't think I have that I don't have that mindset, because like I think I don't know how much. If you're a champion in the mindset, do you think there's other values that you in your character? So stuff like empathy and that. Do you reckon their empathy levels are way too low?
You know that there's things that are overlapping. Like, so, are you familiar with temperament theory?
No, I will.
So there's
some knowledge.
There's a theory called a temperament theory, right? And it comes from Plato and Aristotle, and other people have developed it. And there's four types of temperaments. You've got sanguines, and sanguines are the air. So I think, I can't remember, I'm going to butcher this, Plato or Aristotle, one of them. They said that there's four temperaments in nature, and we have those in our personality. Air. Then you have the opposite end of that is ground.
Yeah.
Then you got water and fire.
Right.
So
the four elements. Yep.
Four elements.
Captain Planet.
Yeah, Captain, pretty yeah, much right, Captain yeah, yeah. Planet. It was deeper than we thought. So, but also there's another, and I think it's the temperament theory is the air is sanguine. Fire is choleric. Melancholic and there's, melancholic is ground and phlegmatic is water. Now, so air is, I'll explain a couple of them really quickly and then you tell me what you think Darius is, right? So air is like animated. They can get a room excited. They make good politicians.
Quick reaction.
Whatever, right? Like they're really good with people. Cholerics, they're the ones who they shoot first, ask questions later. Have you noticed they shoot first, ask questions later? Jordan was a choleric.
You think so?
Shoot. Jordan was 100% is a choleric. 100% is choleric. Ground, they're the ones who sort of say, like you find them as, you always hear them say, I'm only being real. And air and ground always clash.
Right.
Because air's like, oh, we need to do this. This is our dream. This is our vision. And ground will be like, no, but that's not, you know, that the numbers don't line up. That's not being realistic.
So, yeah, but it's a systematical procedure.
Yeah, they're very analytical, right? And then water, they're the calm people, you know, empathetic people, whatever. So now that you know that, what do you think Darius is? Air, fire, ground, or water?
Oh, man.
Air.
Air is correct.
Yeah,
air is correct. So what they say, and I actually really, really believe this to be true, and you should do a temperament test to see your temperament.
Right.
They say that you have one primary, one secondary, and it shifts over time, but it always stays there. So my primary is, I'm like you, Darius. I'm a sanguine. I'm air. You know, I can get people excited.
Right.
I get excited by other people's energy. I can do this with zero sleep, right? I'm not like a water who they get exhausted by.
I'm not systematical.
My secondary is choleric. That's fire. So now I always say this in life. Your strengths are your weaknesses and your weaknesses are your strengths. And you see that with temperaments.
Yeah.
So with air, it's like if an air person doesn't speak from knowledge, like a lot of real estate people are air. They think, oh, you're a blow ass. Not that real estate people are blow asses. Oh, you're a bullshit artist.
Yeah,
right. So an air has a tendency we're also emotional. We can have a tendency to be emotional. But this is what I mean. Your strength is your weakness. Your weakness is your strength. I love this stuff because it makes you comfortable in your skin. You don't have to be like someone else.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? So the fact that, Darius, you and I are emotional because we're sanguines, we're air, it's also our strength, man. It means we can excite people. We're the ones who people look, they want us to carry the room, the energy, the vibe, right?
Agreed.
But it's also a weakness. Now, cholerics are, their strength is they can be ambitious. They can be driven.
They're aggressive. Right?
But they can be aggressive. So I believe like when you know your temperament, your aim in life is to maximize the strength elements of who you are.
The sanguines.
And minimize the weakness part.
Right.
And we all have, and none is better than the other.
Yeah.
So, and sorry for the tangent, right? Hopefully
I like it because it goes in a way how you described it, right? Because you just mentioned about you and I, how we are sanguines about air. So the last four bolts in there, right? I'm reading from here. No, go back. Just go back. So it says, okay, sanguines or air in your, it's sociable, talkative, easygoing, and carefree. Man, I'm that. I'm literally that. Talkative? I'm freaking talkative. But sociable, where break ice easy, no matter what. I'm not
ultimate water cooler.
Yeah,
talkers,
so doesn't matter if you're an introvert. I'll break ice, you know, straight away. So carefree. I'm easygoing. But when you just mentioned about emotional, I think you just said it's a spot on. It is a very spot on.
So we can't change that. And like, people listening to this, they need to realize that, sometimes I get too emotional. But you have to realize that's also your strength. Yeah. Over time, and this is what wisdom, you know, the difference in wisdom and knowledge. Wisdom is over time you have the experience. You know what I mean? Knowledge is you just know something, right? So over time you realize, okay, I put myself through that situation. I'm in business and I have clients. I'm very human in a human industry. So over time, I'm getting better not to get offended by things, not to take things personally because I've just gone through the ringer. You know, now like, and it doesn't happen often, but when a client leaves us, I'm like, well, I'm upset about it, but okay, it's not, because I've gone
it's
through
not
it
the
a
end,
few
is
times,
it? It's
you
not
know?
The end. Yeah.
But I need to, if I know I'm a saint, this is, so if someone's listening like, oh man, I want to be a public speaker, but, you know, say they want to do what I'm doing, they want to be a public speaker, but I'm not like him. You're not supposed to be like me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, with speaking, you, the not the trick, but the aim is how you talk to friends is how you should be talking to onto right. many, right? So whatever, you know, so I know that's, I need to minimize my weakness. My strength is the emotion. So I need to run with it. I need right. to double down on that. What Jordan did, and this is why I brought it up, why it reminded me, because you mentioned the empathy part, right? What Jordan did was, and you see this, right? Now, if you watch The Last Stand, you watch it in a different light. Like he'd say, mate, it's either my way or the highway.
Yeah,
you
know,
like,
that's correct. Get out.
Sanguines are diplomats. We're a bit diplomats. Like, look, listen, you know, like you can do it this way. We like to be diplomatic. But also sanguines, we don't like confrontation.
Wow.
We do not like yeah, confrontation. Right? If it gets to a boiling point and we don't like, we can get to that. And most people can. Once it gets to a boiling point, everyone can have that confrontation. We'll do it if we have to, but we don't like it. We will avoid confrontation.
Mm. I'll be easy going.
Cholerics by default are confrontational.
Right.
Aggressive.
You know right, what I mean? Right. That's why Jordan be like, if you don't like it, get out. Like as a sanguine, you'll watch it and you'll be like, yeah, but why wouldn't you just talk right. to the guy? Why wouldn't you just have a conversation? Why wouldn't you be nice? You need to understand he's not made that way.
Right, right, right.
You know, so now if you watch The Last Stand, you will see it in a different light. And understanding this theory,
we've Who am I?
You're a passive.
I would say, and look, I know a lot less about you than I do about Darius, but I'd say you're either phlegmatic or melancholic.
Yeah,
but I'd have to know more passive, about you.
Yeah. I think passive. I'm green. Yeah.
One thing I do know, just having conversations about you, you are emotionally intelligent. You know how to read people. You know how to probe things. Like even the way you question, you know what I mean? So like, you know, so you're thoughtful.
You're
thoughtful, right? And if you have a point, you dig deeper in that. And that's a mark of a good interviewer. You know what I mean?
See, there you go.
So my wife, she is melancholic, I think. Or phlegmatic. My wife is phlegmatic, right? So she's quieter. Yeah. She's much more empathetic. So by default, they're very, very empathetic people.
Right, right.
You know?
That's why I probably asked the question. That's why it was like
And that was the major tangent, right, the major digress to this.
Right,
but the point is like, so knowing who you are, so if you're Jordan, and I'm sure he figured this out over time. If you're Jordan, like, all right. If he had this, I think this would have helped him because he's like, all right, I am a cleric. I'm this. I shoot first, ask questions later.
Right.
And we've worked for clerics where it's like, why the hell did you do that? It's like, why did you shoot me? Why didn't you like actually open up ask questions later, so, right?
Oh,
he should have realized, okay, this is the way I am. I need to work on my empathy. We're human. We're made this way so we can actually be complete. We can actually figure out the things we're weak on and maximize and like develop those skills, right? And at the same time, focus our strengths.
You know, I'm going to watch back Captain Planet, right? And I'm going to see if
I don't know whether they do it that way. I don't know if the fire guy is aggressive and the water one
is
not.
I want to see. Know what I mean? But how bad? Like, if that'll click, honestly, that'll spin me out. Honestly, if the characters of the Captain Planet match this,
those temperaments, that'd be pretty trippy.
It's like these writers thought that much into it. It was based on this. It was based on a theory.
I like it.
Wouldn't that be crazy or not?
But this is great. See? No.
Yeah, I'd say you're phlegmatic because I can't see you being pessimistic. I think you're... And all the summary we're looking at is a summary of a summary,
yeah.
Right?
It's over,
but,
yeah.
But, you know, phlegmatics, they tend to be like thoughtful, relationship-centered, even-tempered, controlled. That's what I'd guess. But you can do temperament tests for free online. I'm not affiliated with them. Like,
I've never heard of it.
Yeah, this is the first time I've heard about how
it's different to personality.
I've done my personality.
It's similar, but different. This is more your temperament.
So who's a philosopher?
So this has been developed. The reason why I equate it to Air, Fire, Wind, because that's how, and I, again, I'm not knowledgeable enough to know that it was either Plato or Aristotle, one of those guys. They developed that, you know?
Like,
and then like some, you know, some even Arab philosophers at one point took that and they developed it. And then like the way we know now, they call it, you know, the temperament. I think it's called temperament theory, but it's the temperament. Sanguines, phlegmatics, melancholics, cholerics.
I like it.
Like, it opens my mind up. So to be honest,
I honestly think it is so important.
And like when you mentioned about going back into that, how emotional we are. Go, wow. It just hit my trigger right now.
Do you think you have a secondary? Because they say that, you know, you can have a secondary.
Same as Pretty Boy, the green one. What is that? That one. No, I'm not introverted. Definitely not. It has to be cholerics. It has to be the quick reaction.
Yeah.
It has to be.
A lot of,
that, so by the end of the day, I try my best to be introvert.
Why?
But I can't. Because...
Why do you try your best?
I just hold it back. Like, I just... Like, you know I'm changing career, right? In the last 1 year, I've been trying to be... Don't call me professor, just a lecturer in the college.
So, nice.
So I've been doing a lot of assistant training. So, and I'm trying to be, and no matter what I said, that there is, I want you to observe. So, but they said, there's just be you. And I try to mimic Moby, who are systematically how it's done. He said, don't mimic me, just be you, because it won't run.
It's not going to work.
He said, no, I want to follow you because you're smooth, clear, precise, concise, everything, how you deliver. But if it's me, I'm just like from 0 to 100, right? That's always me. I'm always chasing. Like you have to slow down. But don't stop how to be you.
You can trim the edge. You have to trim the edges. We're made a certain way.
But,
you know, you have to.
He goes, don't copy me, because it'll never be you. It'll never come out. So... Because this person's intro, when after the class, he'll just sit down, like just be himself, introvert.
Quiet. To be quiet.
They're quiet. They're analytical.
That's a trait. They don't get their energy from people.
Yeah.
Right? Extroverts get their energy from people. Introverts find it exhausting.
Yeah.
And they're not like, they're not necessarily like some of the best leaders on earth are introverts. Some of the best leaders, they're empathetic. Like, they'll speak, you know, like, you can't tell any difference. Like, they'll speak, they'll get up. They're not shy, but that's not their, like, default. They maybe prefer not to, or they enjoy their more quiet time. Now, me too, and I'm sure you like this too. Like, you know, living a heavy, busy lifestyle, you need the quiet time. Yeah, like, sometimes my wives and the kids, they're... Oh, I said my wives. Not yet. Wife. My one wife. My wife and my kids, plural.
Moby.
not at all. You know, they'll be at my mother-in-law's house. I like that quiet time. You know what I mean? It's not my default. I get the energy out of people.
I've learned a lot today.
Yeah. I appreciate it.
Yeah, I'll open my mind out right now.
It's good.
It's, you know, in a good way. In a good way. And also, I'm going to find my secondary, but I think it's cholerics.
Do the test. I think you can Google free temperament quiz. Maybe we can do it after this. You guys can do it, and let's see what you are. You know,
but other from that, man, I'm just happy to see the whole fam. Yeah, you're an inspiration to us. To me, I don't know.
You're inspiration to me.
Oh, nice. You're very.
If you ask Ernest, of course they're gonna say yes. You know. what do you think, Ernest? Do you need inspiration too? I guess so. Like, it's like, dude, put him on the spot here. You know what I mean? No, I appreciate it, guys.
I'm doing the test right now, all right?
I'm doing the test.
And we are the Double D's.
The Double D's.